Basically, the reason I chose that song is because I was kind of processing the election results, and you know, as we all were, I'm sure, no matter who you voted for, I'm sure you were processing election results. And a lot of us have been praying for a long time before the election, praying for our country, and the whole world was watching this election, and everybody is putting a lot of energy into it. And so I was trolling the internet looking for inspiration, and I found Patricia Cota Robles. She's pretty out there, new agey, but she's got a beautiful spirit, I think. Do you know her, Palma? She has this positive attitude about what's happening on planet Earth, just relentlessly positive. She believes, and lots of other people do too, that, well, I do too, that Earth is awakening, that there's enormous influx of energy coming into planet Earth, and it is pushing all our stuff right up to the surface. Like you have a glass of muddy water, you pour in clean water, all the mud that settled to the bottom comes up. And that's what's happening on our planet. That all that negativity is being brought up by the light to be transmuted. And it's kind of a messy process, like, you know, starting songs over again, you know, singing with a cold. And, you know, the earth, all of us are called to do the best we can to lift up our planet. We're the light workers. Everybody in this room is a light worker. You wouldn't be here. We are called to do our part to hold to the truth we know, hold to the light we know. Even when it seems chaotic, even when it seems like things are getting worse instead of better, it's up to us to hold to the light. So it is kind of funny. I had this topic a long time ago, resist not evil. And I was thinking, this is going to be after the election. Anyway, I didn't vote for Trump, okay? So I thought it was going to be kind of a good topic, resist not evil, because a lot of people thought Donald Trump and think he's evil. A lot of people thought Hillary Clinton is or was evil. There's a lot of that negative energy flowing around out there, and that's what we're called to transmute. So the topic is resist not evil, and I tacked on that, a path to a world awakening. I didn't want this to be a bummer talk. I want it to be an awakening, enlightening talk. So the Bible verse that that comes from, resist not evil, is Matthew 5:39, and I'll just read it in context. And I left my Bible at home, so this is a Gideon Bible. I think it sounds kind of King James-ish. It's old-fashioned words, but let's see what it says. Matthew 5:38. Ye have heard that it's been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, this is Jesus talking, that ye resist not evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel you to go a mile, go with him too. And I say unto you, you have heard it said that you shall love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. So this is our way shower, Jesus the Christ, who calls us to do stuff that it's hard to do, okay? Our radical, beloved way shower tells us to do things like love our enemies. So let's do it. What the heck? So let's define terms. We're talking about resist not evil. What's evil? Deepak Chopra says that, Vedanta says that evil is anything that causes suffering. That makes sense. In my own mind, it's anything that hurts. people, but not just people, but everything, the earth, animals, anything. And everyone, in unity, everyone pretty much understands that evil is separation, separation from God, separation from that reassuring love and peace of God. And it is a belief. We know it's a belief. It's not possible for us to be separated from God. So evil is a belief system which pinches off our good, pinches off. We are able to pinch off God's good from flowing to us. Evil is emotion, fear and anger, that cuts us off from that sense of oneness with God and leads us to those actions which may hurt other people or other living things. And really evil, to me, evil pretty much always leads to control issues. Greed and corruption and wanting to control other people's lives to the point of killing them, that's ultimate evil. That's all control issues. It's control issues based on fear. Fear that no one is taking care of us, fear that there is no God, fear that we're out all alone here on this planet and we have to control everything. But we choose, as light workers, choose to believe and know that God is real, that we can keep our channel to God open at all times. Eckhart Tolle prefers to, instead of saying evil, he prefers to say insanity or extreme unconsciousness. He says it's a manifestation of the pain body, which he talks about the pain body. Tim talked about it in a talk, which I was glad to hear a while back. The pain body contains all of our negative emotions. And there's a collective pain body, which is a merging of all our pain bodies. And really, every negative thought or emotion that's ever been thought is out there somewhere. So it is our job to not let that affect us. So let's talk about how do we deal with evil or the appearance of evil in our lives. Because for most of us, thank God, I mean, there is no really bad evil. I mean, we didn't live in Nazi Germany. We didn't live in, you know, slavery in America or slavery back in Roman times. Mostly evil to us is things we see on TV and just things we don't like in our lives, you know. We can call evil, you know, the neighbor next door plays their music too loud or something. So, but I wanted to share with you an experience I had about evil, why I'm even giving this talk. This was like last year about this time. I worked with this wonderful healer on the internet. I was in her group and everything. But she started talking about her spiritual beliefs in duality. Like she saw herself as like a warrior to fight evil. And she was always talking about negative entities and blah, blah, blah. And it really turned me off. I just didn't want to deal with it anymore. But it upset me too. And I realized this is happening for some reason. And then another of my favorite healers, Masajati, talks about dark entities too, because he works with all kinds of people, not just light workers. He works with everybody. He died twice and came back with healing powers. And so he never believed in any of this stuff, but in his work, he comes across like what you could call evil spirits or dark energies that latch a hold of people because they believe in them, because they have matching energies. So I was thinking about all this stuff. Here's me, this person, 30 years in unity, where we taught the very first principle of unity is God, the good, omnipotence, one presence and one power. We do not acknowledge any source of darkness. We do not acknowledge like there's a devil that makes us do bad things and all this kind of stuff. So here I'm thinking about all this stuff, and I had this experience. I was just lying in bed one night, and this horrible energy being was just like right on top of me. And I have never experienced anything like that before or since. And the only thing I could, while it was happening, the only thing I could relate it to was it was just a feeling of evil, and the only thing I could relate it to was I read stories before about someone who started to go into a house or a barn or something or a place, and they just felt this overpowering sense of evil, and they just hightailed it right out of there. And they found out the next day that there was an escaped mass murderer in there or something. So I guess, and they were, so that's what I was feeling, this just horrible evil energy that I'd never felt before. And so I'm lying there in bed, and because I had, oh, what I forgot to tell you about what Master Jyoti said was that evil has to bow to the light. He, like us, acknowledges that there's only one presence and one power. And so the way I view that is separation is just a thought in the mind of God that human beings got stuck in. Duality is just something that we got stuck in and we're still experiencing. But it's all part of God. It's all, really, you might say, controlled by God. That's the way I look at it. God lets us have experiences of duality, but God is still the one presence and the one power. So I'm thinking about all this evil being is on top of me. I'm thinking, okay, Ma says evil has to bow to the light. And so I wasn't scared. It was really weird. I wasn't scared at all. I just kind of clicked right into my spiritual power. And I poured out light as much as I could, but I wasn't like desperate to pour out light or anything. I was just kind of hanging out, okay, and I'm having this experience. I was just kind of allowing it. And I poured light, and I just, in my own heart and mind, I was just acknowledging, I am the light, I answer to a higher power. This can't hurt me. I don't know what I did, but it went away. It just went away. It just was gone. It didn't last that long. And it was just like a challenge, you know, this thing had this energy. I'm challenging you. I'm going to see how you react to this. And I passed with flying colors, and he just left. And I've never had any experience like that since, and I hope I never do again. But if I do, I'm not scared. So why did I have this experience? I've asked my guidance, and why am I telling you? I don't know why I'm telling you. You'll have to figure that out for yourself. But when I'm looking at what I got out of that experience, and I realized it was kind of a workshop in resist, not evil. The first thing is, in resist, not evil, you're kind of acknowledging that there is the appearance of evil. And I'm a good unity person. I don't want to deal with that. I want to stick my head in the sand and pretend like nothing bad ever happens. I mean, that's just kind of the way I am. I never watch the news or anything. So it kind of got me out of denial and the fear I was avoiding about the appearance of evil in the world. And that's number one. And number two, it convinced me there was nothing to fear. And three, it affirmed what there is to do and not do when you're confronted with the appearance of evil. So what there is to do, accept, allow, be present, love. I can't remember if I actually sent love. I know I sent light. And identify, this is the main thing, identify with your own spiritual identity, your own spiritual power. Because I think that's what these dark entities, I guess they do exist, are looking for, is us wavering, doubting, and, you know, they're trying to see if they can get us to fall off our true knowing of who we are as spiritual beings. So the other thing that was kind of showing me is what not to do. Don't resist, don't fight. And I didn't. I did not fight it. I just let it be and got into my spiritual power. So, let's talk about fear a bit. Why don't we have to fear evil? Well, for one thing, it's really not real. It's all a part of God expressing in all realms, including a dualistic realm. But it also, and I got this from Abraham. Abraham is a channeled collective, channeled by Esther Hicks. Anybody not know Abraham? It's good stuff. I keep thinking Jesus would love. I know Jesus loves Abraham. But anyway, it's really good stuff. They have a way of putting the same spiritual truths we talk about in Unity in very amusing, interesting, clear ways. I just love Abraham. So Abraham says, just because something exists doesn't mean it has to affect you. You have to be on the same vibrational wavelength. This is the law of attraction, to attract something into your life. So I attracted that energy because I was thinking about, evil stuff. And I attracted it for my good. And everything comes to us for a good, but we have to be on the same wavelength to even get in the vicinity of it. Just like on a radio, you can't dial in a radio station unless the numbers are close, So Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. If we're pure in heart, we don't have to worry about evil. It's that simple. And I know, and Rochelle and I have talked about the stupid, crazy things we did, like in dangerous cities and stuff, but we were so innocent that nothing bad ever happened to us. Anyway. And then again, duality. I think the reason there's nothing to fear about evil is, or duality is, that duality has its uses. Evil has its uses. It shows us it's a choosing point. It changed my life when I was a little kid, reading about Nazi Germany. That was a choice point in like second or third grade or whenever I read that stuff. It was pretty early. And reading about slavery, that was a choosing point for me. I choose the opposite. I choose treating people with love and respect and equality. And that's what duality is good for. That's why we came here, to live in a dualistic world, is so that we can choose. We can see all this stuff, and we can decide this is what I want and turn it into this is what I do want. And living in a dualistic world gets us out of complacency and helps us to focus. Eckhart Tolle says suffering is a great way to enlightenment. That was kind of his path to enlightenment. He was a miserable human being. One day he just got sick of it and God got a hold of him. So anyway, it's a choosing point. So that's another reason not to fear evil or fear duality, because it's ultimately all for good. And so I choose to see what's going on in our country that way. All this fussing and fighting and seeing each other as evil. It's a choosing point. It's really got me on my toes, I'll tell you that. And all the light workers in my world, on the internet mostly, who are reeling, they're all saying, okay, this is it. This is our time. We got to step up. It's our job to transmute all this negativity that's coming up. And so we're going to get to it. Okay. So what did Jesus say in that statement from Matthew? He said, resist not evil. That means don't fight. Don't fight. Don't fight evil. And why not? Because what you resist persists. This is a truth. I probably learned this mostly from Abraham again, but Jesus talks about it too. I don't have exact Bible verses, but I remember a long, long time ago when something... Someone told me this a long time ago in the 80s when I worked at Silent Unity. What you resist persists, and that is the truth. What we fight against, we give power to. That is just the truth. That's the law of attraction. I got this from Abraham, and I know it's true. Whatever we focus on with great emotion, whatever we say yes to with great emotion, comes to us. Whatever we say no to, whatever we resist and fight and say that's bad and evil, that comes to us too. And really, that's why Donald Trump got elected. Not just because so many people passionately love the guy, because so many people passionately hate the guy. That's how he got elected. I truly believe that. So I was one of them, you know, resisting. So, but that's something we can learn. That's something we can learn. All the war on terrorism, the war on poverty, the war on drugs, none of that ever works because war doesn't work. Evil, if you want to call it, or separation, needs anger and fear and hatred to feed on, so it's just like feeding it. And that's something that we need to really learn. And those of us who are inclined to want to change the world, and we see all this stuff out there that we know needs changing, and we all have something, I'm sure it brings to mind right away, we need to turn it around to something we are for. You know, whatever it is, whoever it is you see as evil out there, for me it's like Monsanto, poisoning the planet, you know, poisoning our food supply. And what I want to do about that, how I want to turn that around, instead of being against Monsanto, I want to be for organic farmers and people choosing to eat healthy food and people growing their own food and people demanding good food and all that kind of stuff. That, I'm just using that as an example. Whatever it is you're against, turn it into something you're for and put all your energy and power into that. So, Jesus said, resist not evil. But what did Jesus say to do? Well, Jesus is big on non-resistance, accepting and allowing. And all, really, the highest spiritual teachers all are. Sometimes that is the hardest thing, to just stop. Whenever evil confronts us, just stop right there. It's like the fire people say, stop, drop, and roll. This is like, spiritually, stop, allow, and then decide what to do about it. So the first thing is just to accept what is. I had one of my healing teachers once had a spiritual teacher who said, whose mantra was, accept what is without resistance. Accept what is without resistance. And that is just like a first step. Eckhart Tolle, whom I love and adore, I have him on in my car all the time. He says, whatever happens, especially if you don't like it, accept it as though you had chosen it. That's your first step. That is going to get you where you want to go. That's your first step. Because why would that be? Because allowing is trusting in that stream of good that is our source, that is the ultimate reality, that one stream of good. And allowing it and trusting in it is trusting that life is leading us where we need to go. So Eckhart says too, when you allow or accept anything, or when you're faced with your pain body, you bring presence into that. Presence. Just be present with it. Just let it be. Be present with it. And what I sense is that when I bring in that presence, that is the presence of God. That is the presence of God. And that's what changes everything. Remembering that is reality. That's all there is the presence of God. That is the truth. We have the power to pinch it off, but when we bring the presence of God into any situation, that is the answer. That is what soothes us and allows us to move forward. And in that place, once we do the allowing and the accepting, then that calms our egos right down. So instead of like getting in a war with the people we disagree with, our ego is soothed and we can actually listen to Trump supporters or, you know, whoever, you know, somebody who works for Monsanto or whoever it is that you're just, I'm right and you're wrong. It gets us in this place where we could actually sit down and listen to somebody with a different point of view and really be open to it and look for those commonalities, like in nonviolent communication. We are taught that we all have needs, and that's our commonality. We all have the same basic needs, and we all have the same basic desires. Okay. So what else did Jesus say in that Bible verse that we can do about evil? He basically said, raise up your consciousness, take the high road, rise out of victim consciousness and live in your spiritual power. But the part about if someone asks you to walk with you 1 mile, go two. In those days, they were occupied by the Romans, and a Roman soldier could ask any Jewish person. The Jews were the oppressed people. A Roman soldier could ask any person to carry their pack. I guess the law said 1 mile. And that was just kind of a humiliating thing. You know, person that happened to would feel like a victim. They would feel small or whatever. But Jesus said, don't resist that. Allow that. And don't go just 1 mile. Go two. And then that changes the whole energy of the situation. Now, Ed Townley, who's a Unity minister that I knew long, long time ago, I looked at this verse up on the internet, resist not evil, and he talks about that whole thing about going the second mile. He says, now the energy of the situation has completely shifted. The soldier who has been dominant thanks to the power of Rome is now the recipient of a gift thanks to the power of God. And the victim has become an expression of the love that God is. So any stress or anger that's put into a situation like that only blocks God's good, God's presence. But by allowing God's eternal presence to express, even, you know, when we have to accept something we don't particularly like, by allowing God's eternal presence to express, we will always prevail. That's what Ed Townley says, and I think that's absolutely true. I mean, that's why Jesus is always telling us to resist not evil, because it brings us into our spiritual power. We realize that we're much greater. The God is much greater than any sense of separation and any manifestation of separation. Okay, so now we get to the good part, love. Love your enemies. Pray for those who spitefully use you. And that is pretty darn clear. That's pretty hard to misinterpret. Love your enemies. Pray for those who spitefully use you or persecute you, however you define that. You know, pray for your bullies. And really, I was kind of talking to Jamie about that a little. Pray for those bullies because they just feel bad about themselves. And that changes everything. Pouring love into a situation changes everything. And we're getting to the end of the talk now, and I want to read a really inspiring passage that I got from Abraham. Kind of makes me cry. I'll try not to cry. Abraham says, you could be one who could stand in your alignment and hold someone who has been completely regarded as evil by every other person who's ever looked at them, and you could see them through the eyes of Source. That's what Abraham calls God, Source, the one true Source, as they are in their true self, not in their deprived state of being, and your mere gaze upon them could touch them in a way to make them feel the thing that they've been seeking always, which is to be touched by the love of the Source that is within them, that they had somehow lost track of some time ago along their trail. Isn't that something? Your mere gaze upon them could touch them in a way to make them feel the thing that they've been seeking always, which is to be touched by the love of the Source that is within them, that they had somehow lost track of sometime long ago. And that's all evil is. It's just losing track of that love of God. And she continues, and nothing will ever soothe you more or satisfy you more than being a catalyst of upliftment to those who are seeking it but have not found their way. So we can sit in our living room and change the world. We can love our enemies. We can shower love. We can help people energetically open that channel to the love of God, which sources us all. We can behold the Christ in each other. So this is how we help the world awaken. as I said, this election has really inspired me to get on, get in gear and start doing what I know I came here to do. I mean, really, I believe that all of us who are alive at this time are here to help the world awaken. And sometimes we lose track of it, and sometimes we get discouraged, and that's why we need to encourage each other. So here's what I'm committed to, and I, of course, I'll fall off the wagon, as we all will. But I am going to be grateful for this motivation this election has brought. I'm going to pour love on anyone and everyone, anywhere and everywhere on our planet, anywhere I might judge as being wrong or bad or evil, or my enemy in any way. I'm going to pray for Donald Trump and every his cabinet and every all his supporters, and I'm going to choose to see the Christ in them. I'm going to see the God in him, the good in him, and focus on any little thing he does good. I'm going to focus on that. And I'm going to use what I don't like that I see in the world to help me focus on what I do want. And I'm going to strive to live up to my divine I am. I'm going to seriously take Jesus as my way shower and try out his radical suggestions, like loving my enemies and resisting not evil. And so it is. Amen. Okay. This is the meditation song. We're going to do a little meditation about in a minute, but this song, it's called Allowing. It's all about allowing, allowing peace within, in absolute surrender. Serenity begins. For when the storm subsided and calm becomes the way, it's all about allowing it to stay. It's all flow. It's setting down your burden and just simply letting go. For as you cease the struggle and love pours through your heart,